Thank you all for interrupting your Pokemon Go questing to join us this afternoon. We appreciate you taking time out of your very busy Comic-Con schedule to meet some of the debut authors from recent months, some of whom are so debut that their books aren't actually appearing until the future. So we're here for the new authors making a splash in the literary pool. I'm Mary Elizabeth Ittiraldi of Mysterious Galaxy Books here in San Diego in Southern California. Thank you. And I'm going to be introducing you to your new next favorite authors, starting with Bob Frohl. Welcome.
Hi.
So Bob is an established author, but a debut novelist. Is that correct? So, and we like his pedigree because he was formerly a bookseller, so points for that. So he grew up in Buffalo, New York. His local comic shop was Queen City Bookstore. He did work as a bookseller and a programming director for Buffalo Street Books. He's worked as a DJ, a record store owner, and a bartender. And he has written for the 33 and one-third book series. For those of you who are younger in here, that refers to the speed at which a record played. And he also has worked as a columnist and reviewer for the arts and culture site popmatters.com. And his book is 100,000 Worlds. Welcome, Bob.
Thanks.
And next we have Sylvain Neuville.
Close enough.
So, which would be much more correctly pronounced if I was French-Canadian, but I'm not. So he is the author of Sleeping Giants and the upcoming sequel Waking Gods, which was a fantastic first pick for Mysterious Galaxy and has received a lot of acclaim. He dropped out of high school at 15 in the journey. No!
Don't do that.
In the journey to becoming an author, he has been a journalist, worked in soil decontamination, sold ice cream in California, and peddled furniture across Canada. You can move this one. He received a PhD in linguistics from the University of Chicago.
See, for a dropout, not bad.
He taught linguistics in India and worked as a software engineer in Montreal, and he is a certified translator, although he wishes he were an astronaut. And one of the things that I love the most is when I asked him for phonetic pronunciation, because you never know when Todd Lockwood is not going to be Todd Lockwood. So I asked all my panelists. I actually got his response partially in International Phonetic Alphabet. So welcome.
You did ask.
I did ask. And now we welcome Todd Lockwood.
Hi.
So Todd, in addition to providing me with the most straightforward to me name of my panelists today, is familiar to many, many readers and has been for a long time prior to becoming a debut novelist, because his art has appeared on New York Times best-selling novels, industry magazines, and fantasy and science fiction games. You probably recognize it from Dungeons & Dragons, Magic the Gathering. He's won more than 15 ELSI Awards, including the Lifetime Achievement Award and 2 World Fantasy Art Show Awards. He lives in Washington with his wife and 3 children, and his new work is The Summer Dragon. Welcome, Todd. So I love the fact that Alwyn Hamilton, my next author, is dressed in a way that I think Belinda Carlisle would dress, because she has one of those earworm book titles. So her book is Rebel in the Sands, but I always get Circle in the Sand by Belinda Carlisle playing in my head when I talk about her book title. So,
for those of you who are younger, Belinda Carlisle was a musician in the 80s.
Which were only like a decade ago, right? The number of things that were in the 80s that are having like 30th anniversaries is kind of horrifying. Anyway, Alwyn was born in Toronto and lived between Canada, France, and Italy until she was three, when her family settled in a small French town. She studied the history of art at King's College, Cambridge, graduating in 2009, and she now lives in London. She'd worked at Christie's as a senior administrator in the interior department before becoming a full-time writer. And as mentioned, her book is Rebels in the Sands. And from the future, we have author Kira Drake. Kira's forthcoming book, which will not be released until 2017, is The Continent. And she is a full-time author who enjoys writing poetry and music in addition to novels. She's an avid gamer with a soft spot for titles that feature epic and astounding storytelling. Her favorite series include Fallout, Assassin's Creed, and Halo. When she's not writing or gaming, she's likely reading, napping, painting, drawing, or spending time with her husband and 7-year-old daughter. She is a native Californian who has been transplanted to Utah, and we understand that she misses California. Welcome back.
Thank you.
And fellow transported Californian K.S. Mirbeth was previously a resident of Tucson. Her new novel is Bite. She was caught with airplane issues. She will be attending Comic-Con. The Hachette booth downstairs in the 1100 aisle will be hosting her for a signing for her What If Those Awful People in the Apocalypse Who Are Always on the Opposing Team Somehow Really Were Actually the Good Guys novel, Bite, and you can meet her down there if you are interested in finding out more about her book. But she will not be with us. So, welcome authors, welcome readers. So the first thing that I thought...
She's here in spirit.
The first thing that I thought I would ask my panelists is whether they find comparisons challenging, inspiring, or both. I mean, on the one hand, it's kind of nice to have somebody say, this is the next whatever. But on the other hand, maybe it's a little intimidating. Maybe you're like, well, you know, my dragons aren't really so much like the dragons of Pern, to make an easy comparison. So, Todd, having sort of segued into it with that, would you like to start?
Okay, well, the truth is I haven't read Pern, although I did devour the covers. I wanted to be Michael Leland. No, my dragons are... They're animals, they're not mystical, although there are also mystical dragons. You just have to read it.
Anybody else feel inspired by comparisons or challenged by them, or?
I mean, I think comparisons are sort of, they're more useful for readers, because what you want, it's sort of like Amazon being like, oh, you've bought this, perhaps you would like to buy this. A lot of the time when I read something and it said it's something meets something, I get it on a sort of superficial theme level, but I'll think, oh, it reminds me a lot more of, you know, when you get in depth to it, of this and this and this, and everyone's got different references. It's kind of just a nice way to lead you into it. So I wouldn't ever read too much into it if someone said, I've heard yours is blank meets blank, but when I read it, it reminded me much more of blank, because everyone has their own take on it from a reader point of view.
Right.
Sorry, I'm not really talking to the microphone. That's not helpful. Sorry.
Don't get me wrong. I'm happy to be compared to Pern. Somebody in one of the reviews said, I grew up on Pern, so this was the perfect book for adult me.
Nice.
Yeah, I think it's... Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. No, thank you.
I was just going to say, I find... I've had a lot of different comparisons, and like you were saying, like it's like for every person, they're coming from like a specific reference point. So I think with The Continent, it's kind of a strange like genre book, because it's a fantasy, but there are sci-fi elements. And it's also a survival story and an adventure story, and there's a romance. So it's like it sort of can't be put in one thing. So I hear a lot, like, I've never read a book like like this before. So that makes me happy because I think if someone were to compare it to like an existing novel, like, you know, something amazing, that I would feel a lot more pressure and that would be too scary. So
yeah, I think comparisons and genre too are just sort of marketing shorthand and ways to, particularly for new authors, to introduce them to readers who have no other context for them. So this book came out and was being compared to Cavalier and Clay, which they both have comic books in them. And I'm totally happy if everyone who bought Cavalier and Clay buys my book as well. But it's very much just, it's like a little sleight of hand to get you to meet me.
Yeah, my comps are, well, they're based on the format of the book. Sleeping Giants has a unusual format, so it's being sort of sold as in the vein of The Martian or World War Z, no pressure. but I have, I mean, in terms of story, one has very little to do with the other. That said, I would really like to read a Mark Watney adventure on a zombie-filled Mars at some point.
So, when you got your idea and you thought, I have something here, how did you determine where to begin your character's story? How did you determine whether to give a lot of setting and then throw your character into crisis, or whether to start in crisis mode, or what the path was? I mean, to a certain extent, Bob, yours seems to have a very natural progression because it's a journey story, and so you start at the origin, but everybody has sort of different ways of approaching this. So how did you figure out this is the beginning of the story?
I think you start out as close to the crisis moment as you can. You know, I had an earlier draft where they were kind of, there was like 30 pages of them getting ready for the journey, and that's kind of dull, and a lot of that got cut to get them right into, to get your characters moving as quickly as possible. And I think a lot of that gets done in editing.
Well, I tend to write based on strong visuals. I start with some just cool images in my head. For this book, it was easy. It's a little girl lying in the palm of a giant metal hand, and I just had to start with that. And the sequel has a few of those like strong visual moments, and I just go chronologically from one to the next, I guess.
I kind of started with anger. I just needed to talk about things. So this story really started with the theme and dragons. And the characters found their way into it from there. Basically, it's two empires at war with each other, and the dragons are their tanks or their aircraft. But those dragons have to come from somewhere, and I figured I'd start at a beginning and put it on an area where they raised dragons for the Empire's war machine, and made my heroine one of those people. And like you said, go as close to a crisis moment as you possibly can at the beginning. But really, the characters are built to support the theme for me. I didn't start with a character and then try to stick a story onto her.
I mean, I don't know what everyone else does when they're trying to fall asleep, but I lie there imagining scenes from books that I haven't written yet. And so that's sort of how this one started, being like, lying in bed, being like, I really wish I could sleep. Well, what if, you know, in my imagination I'm playing with the scene, and then there's a shooting contest, and then they jump off a train, and then just sort of unraveling all these different scene ideas that I think would be cool in my mind. And then from there, it's kind of connecting them. So the first scene in the book has almost always been the first scene, the jumping off point. But it's definitely not the first one I imagined. It was sort of, I pictured another scene later on and was like, oh, well, what would need to come before there to make this sort of cool idea I'm having make sense, and then build them bit by bit. And it probably started with the character, I think, much more than anything else, and then setting piled on from imagining what kind of scene she would be playing out, because I knew I wanted to write about a young female sharpshooter, and then sort of putting her in a Western meets Arabian night setting, and then kind of pulling out scenes that could fit in those two genres, basically.
My book stemmed from the idea of, well, I was listening to the radio, and there was a woman being interviewed, and her city was being bombed, and she was talking basically about how her and her family would sort of huddle together at night listening to the bombs going off and just basically not know if any moment was going to be their last. So I was thinking how, you know, we listen, I was like crying listening to the radio and thinking how we hear this stuff on the news all the time and we are like, that's so sad, those poor people. Then we kind of turn it off and go to Starbucks, you know, and do our thing, pick up our kids, and that's our privilege because we don't live in a country where that type of thing's going on. So I wanted to start the story. I had the idea, which was, what if someone like me, who was privileged and sheltered, was suddenly thrust into a situation from which they could not escape, a war-torn environment, and what would you even do? So I wanted to start the story with the eye on that privilege. So I think it begins in a very elegant sort of party where it's clear that this girl has everything going for her in the world. She's got an apprentice cartography set up, and she is going to be very privileged and special and successful, and she's set up for everything. And then I decided that she needed to have all of that taken away from her. So that's where that's where it starts. I think it was pretty easy, but it was pretty easy to figure out where to go.
All right, so in the process of preparing for this panel and reading the panelists' books, I enjoyed different aspects of all of them, but I found a passage from part of 100,000 Worlds that I thought, thank you, Vanna, that I thought was interesting because it's about story and would sort of maybe make an interesting thing for everybody, except Bob has to go last because he's already had way more time than everybody else to think about this, to address. So Alex, one of the protagonists of the story, is thinking a lot about story. He's thinking about his own story. He's thinking about the stories that the people around him create. His mother is a theater and television performer. He knows a lot of creators. They're traveling Comic-Con to Comic-Con across the country, encountering a lot of people who are creating stories. And so the passage is, the question Alex wanted to ask was, what happens if the ending isn't the one you want? What he wants is to be able to step in before the ending happens and change it, although he knows the idea man, one of the creators, would probably say that's cheating and makes for a bad story. But he'd mean for the readers. And Alex knows it's important to give the readers a good story, but what he's wondering is if it's important to make the characters happy, too. If there's something they're owed for coming this far and for trying so hard. And if both things are important, which is more important? And if he can't make both happy, whom should he choose? So, facing that dilemma, because without conflict, you don't have story. And so your characters are always going to be facing conflict and dilemma. Whose feelings are more important? Is it, do you owe those characters anything, or do you only owe the readers good story? Well, sorry, I gave them pre-panel questions, and then I sprung this one on them.
Yeah.
It's just a really easy question.
Trickery.
No, please start.
There's a correct answer to this, by the way.
Yeah.
I will judge each of your answers.
No. Yes.
It's slightly later in the book.
Okay. Yeah. Well, the only thing I feel I owe the characters, and I love those people, is to give them interesting pain. But that's about it. Other than that, if these people were alive, they would like hire people to shoot me because I put them through hell. Yeah, I'm not good to them in any way.
No, if you're too nice to your characters, you have a boring story.
If we're talking about the ending, I mean, mine is a trilogy, and I'm a firm believer in the sort of Star Wars construction of trilogies, that at the end of the first one, you should get to leave them happy. They've been through a lot. You can make them miserable at the end of the second one and leave everyone frozen in carbonite if you have to. And then the third one, same. That's sort of the arc it should take, because when you're writing a trilogy, I think people should have the option to stop after the first one if they want to. So end it in a place that is satisfying for the reader. That's important to me in a series. So.
I think the operative word there was some. You said leave them some happy.
Right. Yes. Right. Not everyone. Not everyone gets to be
happy. No, I mean, they get to have some happy.
Yes, yeah.
They don't get to be all happy.
No, I don't think you should completely have resolved the issue, because then you've got two more books to write. but sort of leave in a place that isn't, completely perilous and awful for everyone at that moment. But there's still a ways to go, but, and people can have died and misery can have happened, but hope at the end of the first book is important to me. Yeah.
They're getting medals, but Darth Vader got away.
Exactly. That's exactly what I mean.
Yeah. I feel that with the characters, the only thing that you owe them is authenticity. I think that it's really important to not make a character do something because you think it would be cool or because it's going to read well, but if it doesn't track with who the character is or, what really would be motivating them and how they would react to that, that's the only time I ever get writer's block, is when I'm trying to write something that's just not authentic, and I can always recognize it when it happens, because I get stuck and I say, okay, I have to, try this again. So I think, especially writing young adults, teenagers can smell, inauthenticity a mile away, and they don't have any interest in it, and they don't want things sugar-coated, and that's awesome, because a lot of people think that young adult is like, oh, are they pandering? Are you talking down? And that's like absolutely the last thing that you should do, because teenagers are brilliant, and they're on to you, so anyway.
I think, that's a passage that comes towards the end of the book, and I had gotten very attached to my characters to the point of being overprotective of them. It's also something that happens when you're writing about a 9-year-old kid, and you have a 9-year-old kid in your house at the time. But, I mean, he's mine. I just realized I accidentally did the Stephen King's "I have the heart of a young boy, it sits in a jar on my desk" line.
Actually, it was originally Robert Block.
Oh, I didn't know that. All right, I'm sorry.
That's what helps. Being old helps.
it became a problem to sort of force myself to put these characters in danger for the sake of the story, or let them be at a little more risk, but. It's vital for the readers, and the readers generally understand that, and that's, as much as the readers might be rooting for the characters to have happy endings, what's more important, I think, is something that's authentic, that's true to the story you're telling and true to the characters that you're writing.
Well, I think we're getting hung up on happy. I mean, you can have some tragic triumph or a small victory, but it doesn't have to be happiness.
Never that.
Damn happiness.
I was at a convention in Houston before the book came out, and we were giving away copies of the book, and this young woman came up to me and said, "I only read books with happy endings. Does yours have a happy ending?" And I said, "How do you feel about ambiguous endings?" And she walked away. We were giving away the book. Like, you could just take it. And she turned around.
Define happy.
All right, and one last question, which is going to be briefly about process, and then we'll open it up to the audience. So to get from an idea to a completed work takes discipline, and a lot of times in the audiences, as well as having readers, you have people who are also working on writing and who are often curious about process. So what was your process and what was your discipline that took you from the idea to the completed manuscript?
Why don't we start down there?
No.
What? Okay. I was trying to be gentle.
Go for it.
Go ahead.
I'll take the bullet. I mean, like I sort of mentioned earlier, I always kind of imagine scenes and then string them together. The very first nugget of an idea for this one was young female sharpshooter, and then from there, it was, that's a Western, and then the next thought was, I don't want to write a Western. I'll combine it with the Arabian Nights and write a fantasy. And so it was sort of pulling out different scenes or things that could fit into that and then stringing it together as a story all in my mind so I knew where it was going, because I find it quite difficult to write if I don't know what I'm writing towards, or if I'm not like looking forward to the next scene that's gonna, you know, if I just finish this really difficult plot point that I don't really know where it's going, I can write a fun kissing scene later, which is, you know, so I basically wrote a really messy first draft of pulling it all together. There are bits, I'm sure it's still somewhere, of my first draft that'll just say, and then something happens here, plot, and then I'll move on, just to sort of get it all down on the page. And a lot of the time that becomes clear as I sort of write something later on, be like, oh, because I need a scene where this happens here, that needs to have happened there. So wrote a really messy first draft and then rewrote it. And then it still wasn't very good. And then we wrote a bunch more. But I knew I could finish a book by the time I wrote this, because I'd finished six before it that weren't good enough, that I never tried to do anything with, that live in a drawer somewhere, and that no one will ever see. She says, not meaning to sound it like a threat, but you know. And then sort of just a lot of polishing, basically. But I had to get to the end before I could polish it, because things at the beginning become clear when you get to the end.
I always start with plot points. I always have to, like she said, like I have to have something to which I'm writing toward. I don't understand how people write from the seat of their pants and like just kind of like tell a story, and I think that's amazing and magical, but it doesn't work for me. So I'll start with like what I know is wherever the story will begin, and then sort of like the first act turn where everything will change. Where's a good place to put a reversal, you know, to kind of mix things up and get the plot moving. I try to keep the plot moving along at all times. So I think plot points are important to me, but at the same time, as I'm writing, I don't outline every detail. I like to have a lot of room for discovery as I go, because I like when I'm writing and I will just gasp aloud, you know, and be like, oh, I cannot believe that just happened. I can't believe she said that, you know. So I like to be surprised. I think my surprise translates into your surprise. So sometimes I think a little bit of planning as well as just pure free creativity is how I do it.
I'm going to use an art metaphor. when I'm doing a painting, it starts with little thumbnail drawings. They're the size of your thumbnail. And you can only see the very biggest shapes. And if you don't know what they are, then it would be meaningless to you. But you begin with the big shapes, and then you start to refine them, and you start to carve into them, and you throw out the ones that aren't working, and you bring in the ones that are. And by the time you do a thumbnail, then you do a sketch, maybe a value study, and then a full-on drawing. And by the time you're getting to paint, you pretty much know the shape of everything and where everything belongs. I do want a little more room for discovery than that. And there's always changes, and especially painting digitally, I can remove a character if they're not working, or turn them around or whatever. But it started with the big ideas first, the big shapes, and some of the details. But in a painting, the details come last, and that's really the crafting of the prose, I guess, in writing.
Well, I spend a lot of time plotting, but I spend an inordinate amount of time figuring out what perspective I'm going to use for each chapter, because it changes every single chapter in there, and the feeling you'd get from the book would be entirely different if it was someone else presenting their perspective on what's going on at that particular time. So that's actually what I spend most of my time on, is trying to figure out what angle I'm going to present these events in. Once I get that, it takes forever, but once I got that, I just plowed through it a little bit at a time. I wrote this and the sequel with a full-time job and a six-year-old kid. I don't know which is more time-consuming, but it's just, yeah, and I'm in my 40s, so there's no, I'll go to bed at 7 in the morning and just write all night, because then that would, I could do it, but I would pay for it for about 6 years.
Yeah, I wrote the first draft of this book at an artist residency, so I was sort of in the woods for a month with no internet, which is fantastic, by the way. If you can find a way to keep the internet away from yourself, it's like the best thing you could do for your writing. And I went in with a pretty firm outline, and then it was kind of this negotiation between the plot points I had and the voices that I was telling, because I also have rotating points of view. And I remember I was about two-thirds of the way through, and there was going to be this thing that happened, like a big second act turn, this sort of external event that was going to change all the relationships of the characters. And I had been working on the book for like 15-hour days for, you know, almost like 3 weeks at that point. So I was really close to the book. And I was coming up and it was time to write that scene, and the book, I swear to God, just sat down like a petulant little child and was like, no, that thing is not going to happen. That plot point does not work. That's not the kind of book I'm going to be. So no. And I was like, but it's in all my charts, like all of my story maps have this thing happening. And people's like, I don't care, no. So I had to just keep sort of moving along and letting the voices that I was using and the characters in the book tell me where the book wanted to go. And so yeah, like you start from a good outline, because otherwise it can just sprawl into a mess. But you let the book sort of lead you and tell you what it wants to do, to some extent, within limits.
Within the limits.
All right, so do we have questions for our panelists from the audience? Yes.
What was your process for querying, if you did it, and if not, how else did you get from an idea to actually having the host sitting in front of us?
So the question is, what was the author's process for querying, if they did, and if they didn't, how did they go from being completed manuscript to published work?
I mean, I guess mine was pretty traditional. When I was on submission, one of the publishers asked me how I found my agent, and I was like, on the internet, which sounds creepy, but is not. did a lot of I'd written a bunch of things before that weren't ready to query, and I knew that, but I'd sort of done all the back work for it, so I'd spent a lot of time following agents' blogs and things like that, and sort of kind of had a short list by the time I was ready to query, and so I'd like put it all on a spreadsheet. I also wrote my query letter fairly early on, the beginning of writing the book, because then I knew what the book was about pretty well, and I refined it through the process, and then just made sure I had a really good reason why I was querying every single agent that I was querying, whether that was, you know, because you represent something that is similar to mine, or, you know, not to sound creepy, but I've been stalking you for 2 months, and you tweeted about how you liked this kind of book on, you know, this time and this date, and so just sort of went through, followed their instructions, had queried my current agent on a Saturday. She asked for a full on the Sunday. And then she replied really quickly on the next Friday, so I assumed it was a rejection. And I was reading through it being like, where's the part where she's like, I don't want this book. It doesn't seem to be here. And then from there, sort of had to go back to the other people who had the book at that point. So, but yeah, fairly traditional, just a lot of following people's blogs for many years. And if you do that, you'll start to see the same sort of advice repeating until it's almost ingrained, I think.
I'm sort of an anomaly in that I love queries, love writing them, and I love helping other people with their queries. So when I was ready to query, like I was ready to query. Twitter was really helpful for me because there are so many agents on there, you know, literally just talking about what they want and what they're looking for, and making snarky remarks sometimes about things they don't like, and you know, just getting to know them as people. I think was really helpful for me. But by the time I queried, like I wrote mine early as well, and So I queried for 5 months. It was a long process. I had a lot of requests and a lot of rejections, and they didn't really bother me because I love query. And I'm just like, yes, I got another rejection. Done. Okay, move on. Where's the another request? You know, so I mean, if you're not getting requests, that's probably not fun at all. But that just probably means maybe you need to rethink your query or, you know, something like that. But yeah, so my query actually became my jacket copy for my book. So it's, if you ever want help, find me on Twitter, because I love the query whisperer. I love it. So
our advice basically seems to be stalk people.
Stalk. Yes.
Stalk.
That's solid advice.
Within the bounds of the law, you should stalk people.
I like that that's the traditional way now, the traditional way to find an agent. Yeah, I would say ditto to everything that those guys said, and also, like, listen to the responses that you're getting from agents. Be respectful of the time that they, be respectful of the conditions that they put on querying, and follow them. People will shut you down because you don't follow the directions. But if somebody, if an agent takes time to give you feedback, even if it isn't the feedback that you want to hear, you need to listen to that. This is somebody that's taking time to talk to you about your work. Be respectful of that time, be appreciative of it.
I'm the last person you want to ask for querying advice. I gave myself 7 months, I prepared a research, I failed miserably, and I decided to try and self-publish the thing, and I sent it to a magazine for a review. It came back with a fantastic review that somehow caught the eye of a Hollywood producer, and then it just, whatever, Andy Weir-ish. Kind of way. So yeah, no, I sucked at it.
Well, then I may be the second to the last person you want to ask about it, because I sort of came in through the side door. My editor was my friend before she was my editor, and she was my art director and client before she was my friend. So Betsy Wilhelm at DAW is both editor and art director, and we'd known each other for a number of years, and when I first was working on this book, see, I'm such a newbie, because I have a young female protagonist, I was worried, you know, is this going to get called a YA book? I didn't intend it to be YA. And I thought, DAW doesn't do YA. So I started showing it to agents, and I didn't do it with a query letter. I just kind of cornered them at conventions.
Don't do that.
Stalking, cornering.
Stalking. But I got some looks, and some rejections, but Betsy learned that I had a book that I was showing around. She said, if you don't show that to me, I'm going to be offended. So I gave it to her, and she said, I'll read it, and I'll tell you if it's good, and if it's not, I'll tell you why, and if it is, I'll tell you who might be interested or what agent you might approach. And she read it, and she said, I want it. So she was honest, and I think that speaks to something else, which is networking. Go to the conventions and sit in on the panels and meet the authors and get to know people. Otherwise, your manuscript is just one more lump of paper in a tall stack of paper lumps. You know, the networking is really important.
Yeah, my agent was somebody that repped somebody I knew. And that's where you start, is with, like, the agents of people that you know. And ask the people that you know first if they can name drop you, or if you can name drop them in a query letter.
Blind luck helps.
Blind luck is huge.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It's only got to work once, is the thing. Like, 60 rejections and one acceptance is still one acceptance.
Any additional questions? Yes. Do you want to go to the microphone, please?
It's all right.
Or just project.
Okay. Sorry, I'll use my board-breaking voice. Bob talked about what he does when the story did not go the direction he expected. And a couple of you talked about hitting points that you wanted to hit. So what do you do when the point is there and the story does that thing?
You eat food, a lot of food. well, you just, something else always opens up. And it's it's not so much a matter of being able to determine where the story is going to go as being able to see where it's going to go. When your plans, the book is not going to do what you say, like 100% of the time, and the characters aren't going to do that. You have to, there's like a weird magical connection thing, you know, between like character and story and subplot and all of these things working together inside you. And I always say it's magic because I just like can't, like everyone's like, how do you write a book? I'm like, I don't know. I don't know. So I think it's like just a matter of being flexible, being just like as though someone gave you criticism, you know, being open to criticism. It's almost like a criticism from your story, you know, like it's like this is not going to work, you need to do something else. And so just keeping an open mind and flexibility and pizza.
Yeah, it's hard to talk about without sounding like you being like mystical or psychotic.
I know.
But you are sort of, you're in conversation with the book, and like you have to listen to it as much as you talk to it and rarely talk at it.
And the conversation changes as well depending on where it is, because if it's your first book and you don't have a deadline and no one's expecting it, you can do what I did, which is like spend an hour lying on your brother's floor at Christmas while he's like considers whether he could reasonably roll his chair over you, which is what mine did. Well, I was lying on his floor being like, I can't figure it out, and he's sort of just staring at me being like, get out of my room. He's younger than me. Whereas when you have a deadline, that conversation might be a lot more sitting there and just writing it. Oh, nope, that doesn't work. Move on to the next thing. Nope, that doesn't work, because you don't have that time to sort of just think about it and meander over it necessarily as much as you may be used to.
Nancy Cross, who was one of the authors who read me early on and gave me advice and mentored me a little bit, says if she knows where a book's going, she loses interest and she can't write it. She's completely a pantser, which I couldn't do. You know, I pants at the beginning, and then, like you're saying, that you find the scenes that you want, and then you figure out how to weave them together. So.
Yeah, and sometimes it might just be that it's a different way of getting there, but you know where you're going. You know, what you're trying to do isn't working because it's not what the character would do. That was one of my blocking points. I couldn't get it right, and then I realized it was because she'd stopped being in motion for the first time in the book. She'd been moving throughout of it, and then I had her in one place, and I was like, oh, that doesn't make any sense for you. And it just got to the same place, but it's,
keep on moving.
You get where you need to go. You just... maybe don't get there the way you thought you were going to.
Yeah, sometimes the book is smarter than you are. Like, it will do cool things, and you're like, whoa, this is great. I would never thought of that, but what's happening now. Yeah, it will choose for you, and sometimes it will try to do weird things, and you just rein it in, but yeah.
I don't know, but I learned the term pantser doing interviews for this book, and I was horrified that that was a thing. Why would you do that? That's a terrible idea.
Well, sometimes it's just a matter of backing up and setting it up. You know, there was an entire action sequence that I wrote just because I knew it was time for some action, and introduced a character I did not expect, that I hadn't planned for. And so I backed up a little bit, set up a little bit of, you know, foreshadowing, and then forged forward, and it made the book better. So, you know, I was still able to get to the same ending, but it had a whole different depth and feeling, and it was better for it. So yeah, listen to your book.
Also, one of the pros of writing fantasy instead of contemporary is that when you're stuck, you can literally blow something up to move the plot forward, which I have done more than once. There is an explosion somewhere in the first third of the book that was literally that, being like, I need to move on the plot. Well, this will blow up. That works too.
Yeah, that's annoyingly not an option in literary fiction. What if somebody just spontaneously combusted? That would really solve this problem.
Come over to the fantasy side. We blow things up.
That's a great slogan.
Although you did get to blow a few things up in doing your origin stories for your fictional.
Yeah, I mean, there's a couple imaginary things to blow up.
Yeah, I mean, they're all fictional characters, but it's hard to talk about your book. Thank you.
Thank you for having a book that's hard to talk about.
Yes.
I know, and I keep all these conventions I end up on panels with awesome science fiction and fantasy writers, and I'm the guy that's like, there's no dragons in my book. People have to ask, you're like, does anyone have a happy ending in this?
So it occurs to me that we've talked about your books in some ways, but maybe since these are new books / not yet out books, what we should have each of you do is the short recap, synopsis, elevator pitch of what your work is, just in case there's anyone who's like, Todd's book sounds really neat and has dragons. What else? So
I didn't have an elevator pitch until after I had sold the books. Maya is the daughter of a man, a family that breed dragons for the military war machine. The corporate war machine is how I put it at first. Until the day, well, and once a year on midsummer days, near around it, the ministry sends wagon trains to come and collect the babies, and then they will take them away and pair them up with riders. And so her life has always been just raising dragon babies up to a few weeks of age and then saying goodbye to them. She and her brother are all set to acquire dragons of their own this year out of a very big brood, expand the Aries a little bit, and have their own dragons. So it's a big deal for them. But there are calamities elsewhere in the Empire that upset their plans. And when they see the summer dragon, which is not one of the animals they raise, but one of the Avar, which are, they don't know what they are, but they're like gods. They're treated as gods. Suddenly all the factions have a different interpretation of what that means, and she has to undertake a difficult and terrifying quest to get what she wants, save her Aries, and hopefully everything she loves from the machinations of Empire, enemy, religion, and so on.
Right, all we know, sharpshooter, desert, and Western meets Arabian fantasy.
I was just thinking, I have so much less shame than all you guys, because my book is, I've left it propped up, whereas you guys
are being quite modest. You're competing with the Comic-Con logo.
Now you can't look at that.
Competing with the Comic-Con logo.
Rebel of the Sands is, I usually start by saying, it's Wild West meets the Arabian Nights. Stay with me, I know that sounds weird. It's about a young female sharpshooter named Amani who lives in a dead-end town at the end of the desert. She decides that in order to get out, she is going to enter an underground shooting competition disguised as a boy, because what could possibly go wrong with that idea? And of course things do go wrong, and her fate winds up getting quite tangled with another competitor, and the two of them wind up on the run across the desert together in the midst of a rebellion. And that is my elevator pitch.
Give it to me. I want it. My book is a story of a girl, Vela Sun, from a place called the Spire, which is a group of peaceful nations that have transcended the ways of war. And so they... There is another place. For her 16th birthday, she receives a trip, which is like the most coveted gift in all the Spire, which is to tour the continent. And that is a place that's many hundreds of miles to the north, another landmass on which two more primitive tribes have been at war for centuries. So the natives of the continent, or the natives of the Spire, will sometimes go and tour via heliplane to see the spectacle and violence of battle, which is something that is completely unfamiliar to them. It's not necessarily as a source of amusement, but as a novelty, a look into their own past. And so Vela wants to go and see the continent because she is an apprentice cartographer and she wants to work on her maps of the place. But as luck and storytelling will have it, things go very, very, very wrong on her tour and she becomes stranded on the continent, alone, starving, in the middle of a war zone with no survival skills of any kind, and has to try and find a way home, or at the very least, stay alive. So.
I'll go.
In the tradition of the Martian in World War Z.
yeah. It starts with a 11-year-old girl who just rides her bike in the woods. She starts walking because she sees some weird light, and the ground just gives in beneath her feet, and she wakes up in a big square hole lying in the palm of a giant metal hand. 17 years later, she's a physicist, and she leads a team of scientists and pilots scouring the planet looking for big metal body parts buried all over. It's mostly written as a series of interview transcripts between the characters and a mysterious interviewer dude who does crazy things. That's it.
100,000 Worlds is about Valerie Torrey, who's a former cult television actress on a sci-fi television show, and her 9-year-old son, Alex. And they are traveling cross-country, going to a series of comic book conventions from New York to the West Coast. And what Valerie knows and Alex doesn't is that when they get to the West Coast, she has to hand over custody of Alex to her estranged husband and former co-star. Just mine is a shorter elevator ride.
So, and neither of you added, and then things go horribly wrong. But I think we've established
that's implied for all.
It's a book, so.